BLC.
Oh, you have to be an NHL player.
Hello, 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 hello.
This one, right here.
On this one, yes.
It doesn't have some people. Okay. The microphone is working?
Okay, hello. Yes, fantastic. Alrighty. How was I getting full screen again for this?
I don't know, because all the shortcuts are different. Just go view this.
Oh, slideshow. Okay, great. Fantastic. Okay, good afternoon, everyone. Hello. Thank you for attending this short discussion. Uh-oh, what's going on here? Okay, there we go. All right. Okay, my name is C. Sundiata Cowles. I am an award-winning filmmaker, certified technology specialist, and a Blender user. And today we're going to talk about my film, short documentary, a 30-minute documentary I made about a very strange, unique aircraft concept that thankfully never took to the skies. Regardless of what you may think about this, this was actually a real concept. This is what's called an annular wing attack craft. First, forward. All right, a little bit background. My company, Future Insight, was established in 2002. It actually was a webzine, meaning like a journal, and I covered emerging digital filmmakers in my area. I live in New Jersey in the United States, New Jersey, New York, and Pennsylvania. At its height, the readership attained about a 65,000 worldwide readership, repeating myself here. I wrote over 130 articles and interviews before transitioning to full video production in 2010. The following year, I won my first award, a video production on a local community theater called The Making of the Heiress, and it's based on a play called The Heiress. My current production, Designed for Battle, V2L Model 49, and the APHIS program, which this talk is about, has so far won 5 awards. And I want to point out that this is my first time using Blender. Was really amazed at how efficient, effective it was, but as you'll learn over the next few minutes, I really went at this with a sledgehammer. I had no idea what I was doing, and it still worked out. It was a very forgiving program. Okay, so the quest for this project started out because I needed something new for my demo reel. I'd been working previous to this in corporate video, shooting focus groups and things like that, and that's something that's really, you can't use in a demo reel because it's proprietary to the company. So for 2 years I had footage that I couldn't use, so I needed something to sell myself in a new way, so I decided to look at 3D. I am an aviation fan, and I decided to look at making a story about an aircraft of some sort. This strange craft here is called the V2L Model 49, and it really, as I said, was really designed to fulfill a need during the 1960s for the U.S. Army to fight in the Vietnam War. Thankfully, it was never made. The size of it would have been about 30 feet high in real life, and it was supposed to be able to sneak around and ambush enemy positions, and I don't know anything that can be 30 feet high. I mean, we're talking about bigger than a dinosaur that flying around and trying to stop somebody. I decided to use Blender after I first thought of using a stop motion animation technique to do this, to make a sort of retro. And I found it very frustrating beginning with version 2.44 to 2.49. I'm sure many of you will attest to that. Okay, early tests were promising. This picture, oh great, you can see that. I don't know if you can see the cursor there. This picture here was my very first test, and I was thrilled. Yay! You know, I was amazed. I can actually make something with this program. The next picture here on the right-hand side was my first texture of that same model. And I don't know if you can really see it here, but there's seams in the texture. And I really didn't understand how to texture. That's how much a noob I was. You know, I would make my textures go right up to the line and not over. So it looked like I was putting pieces of paper together. The final picture down here in the bottom is a final render still from the actual video. I am a video editor by trade, a video maker by trade, so my equipment when I started this was built for HDV production, really not designed for 3D animation. My file system was again based on video. I had no concept of how to lay out your files and folders for animation as well. Now, this computer that I had built, custom-built, Windows 7 Service Pack 1, 64-bit, Intel Core i7 CPU, 2.67 gigahertz, dual-core, 12 gigs of RAM, sounds like it could do the job. I mean, it on the surface, you know. Not really. Near completion, I had to end up using a laptop that had 2.87 dual-core and 32 gigs of RAM. Overall, I created 210 original animations within five second durations, and utilized about 180 for the documentary. Now that's quite a lot of work. I might say I got carried away, but one of the challenges with building this was the fact that this craft was a concept only. It never existed, so I had to build everything that would probably exist around it. Basically structure a world. Here you see the hero model. It had over 500,000 vertices, 500,000 faces, over 1,000,000 triangles. 724 objects make it up. There's 3 lamps to light it, and took about 153.5 megs and has 184 textures. Now, to alert some of the people who are just starting out with Blender, one thing I didn't know was that when you build a 3D model, you don't have to build every single thing. Okay? It isn't a scale model. You can cheat, but I built piping. I built, you know, fuel cells. I built the ribs and all this stuff. Stuff that you never even see within this model. And you can imagine the rendering times. Even with 12 gigs of RAM, I think my first render for my first scene took a week, and it was wrong. So, learn from my mistakes. Okay, this was actually my second render. This is a shot called The Hangar, and I'm actually going to show you it. If I can escape. Okay. I can just reduce.
I usually just switch like this.
Oh, okay, great. Okay, Hangar. Okay, so this is a.
I'll try. Just play it?
Yes. There's no sound. Okay, great. No sound. Okay, what that was if I can get out of it, yeah.
To switch between what you command and tab, it's like on the.
Fantastic, okay. And then.
And if we spin it,
great, okay. Sorry about that. Okay, that hangar sequence, again, was completely built from scratch. I had no idea what type of a hangar would really be used to house this type of strange aircraft, so I just looked at images online of very large hangars and kind of extrapolated what it would be. Again, we're looking at over 1,000,000 vertices, 1,000,000 faces, 2,000,000 triangles, 1,825 objects. I didn't even know what an array was. Okay, so every single light that's hanging from the ceiling is an actual individual model. Memory 222.43 megs, 112 textures. I kept my compositing very simple because my workflow was to create the scenes in Blender, and if there needed to be any compositing, I would do that in After Effects and then actually edit in Premiere. So this compositing workflow kind of became my default because I really didn't understand how to use the compositor, but I didn't let that stop me from moving forward with the story. Okay, this is the next example called The Crowded Town, and I'm going to try to get back to that again. this one, and yeah. Okay.
Actually, you should probably move it.
Okay.
Which one? You just drag and drop.
Drag and drop.
Yeah. This to here.
Oh, I see what you're saying. Okay.
And then you will just double flash press it.
Okay, no sound as well on this one. Alrighty. Man, I'm
just
terrible.
Switch with Command Tab.
So you can see how much I use a Mac.
Command Tab. This and two times to go to a preview. Like
there we
PC.
Go. Okay.
Yeah.
There we go. Okay. All right. So this was an example. I wanted to create sort of like a. Let me take a step back. All of the scenes that I used for this project, I really created based on either images I saw from actual wartime photos or just something that looked interesting, and I kind of extrapolated it. This was actually based off a painting that had absolutely nothing to do with war or anything like that. And I said, wow, that makes a nice scene. In an effort to make this a very non-political documentary, you don't see any opponents in the battle scenes or anything like that. You may see the craft shooting off screen and something blowing up, but I didn't really want to get into politics with this. Also, as a result, the vehicles that accompany the Model 49, like these things, which are called the Lockheed XM 808 Twisters. These were prototype scout vehicle cars, but again, they were never used in combat. So, sort of a pacifist view of a potential weapon system. Here we have over 4 million vertices, 4 million triangles, 4 million faces, 8 million triangles, 1,766 objects, 7 lamps, and over a gig of memory. The background, if you can see this here, was actually a series of flat planes that I just textured on the building. And trees and things like that. The actual sky in the background was a still photo of a shot I think I took in Slovenia during a hiking trip, and just used After Effects to move in the background with an alpha channel. Again, you can see the same compositing workflow, very simple, kept it simple so I could move this project through. Okay, this next example is called the airfield, and this was one of the larger projects, scenes, I should say, of this project. There we go. Done.
No, you have to look at the file. Oh, you have it?
All right. Oh. What's going on?
It's because the right mouse button is really not easy to do on a trackpad. Just do it like this.
There we go. Okay, also no sound with this one. Okay. Okay, for that scene, I wanted to make it look like there was someone outside of a secure area taking shots with a Super 8 millimeter camera. I used a lot of filters, old film effects, and things like that to sort of make it look like it was from that time. Again, you can see the various components of what made this project up. We have over 2,800 objects down here. This was, I found this one to be a very stubborn challenge. I couldn't for the life of me get the mist tab to work, give me the proper depth of field. So I actually built, if you can see here, these panels, and used a very light opaque shader to give two layers of, I don't know if you guys can see that here, along that. And when you look through them with the camera, you get sort of that increased depth of field into the background. But there were all these things here are actual buildings that I built for the airfield, actually based on an air base that was the American air base during the Vietnam War, so to give it a sense of scale. And here's a better image of those partitions and the buildings. These here little planes were trees. And I also had a difficult time having the trees track the camera when the camera turned. So as insane as it may sound, I actually moved all of these trees by hand to follow the camera, even though you don't even see them, just in case they would be seen. Okay, in conclusion, this project began January 1st, 2012 as a New Year's resolution. It was completed June 6, 2014. Live action and interviews were shot with a Canon EOS 70 HDSLR. Computer models and animation was via Blender versions 2.5 to 2.7. Resolution was 1920 by 1080. However, I did output it to 1280 by 720 because at that time my computer had it. So I felt the smaller the file, the better it could render it out. Overall, I made 14 aircraft models, 12 major locations like the ones I've shown you, 5 vehicle models, and 1 human model that I used over and over and over and over and over. Editing and post-production was done via Adobe Production Premium CS 5.5. I do want to give thanks to the Blender community. Blender Render Sky, I don't know if that person or persons is here. I watched their tutorials, and they really helped me a lot. Blender Cookie, Blender Nation, and especially Roland Hess, if he's watching, fantastic job. I really would not have understood Blender without the Essential Blender Book or the Blender Foundations and Blender Production Books. And that is my presentation. Any questions? Oh, that's my first name. I'll tell you later. Yes, please.
You said that you were new and you made a whole bunch of mistakes. If there was one extra tutorial that would have made life so much easier for you, what would it have been?
That is a very good question. I don't know if everyone heard it. If there was one extra tutorial I could have seen or watched that could have made my life easier, what would it have been? I would have said, file management, knowing where to put your files, how to put your textures one spot, your objects another spot, and your renders another spot, and things like that. I had my stuff all over the place, because when you do video editing, it's a completely different mindset than when you're doing animation, because you're grabbing things from all different places. But with animation, as I'm sure most of you know, it's you want to keep pretty much everything in one folder and then subdivide that way to make things easier. Another thing I would say would be, just to follow up with that, texturing, I guess. I had no idea until the latter stages of this project that you could actually move the UV meshes so that they wouldn't be distorted when you lay it on the texture. I thought once you laid it out, made a UV map, that was it. You couldn't change a thing. And so through a lot of iterations of this hero model, I had textures that just looked horrid. And I would go over and over and over and over until I Blender Foundations came out by Roland Hess, and I was amazed. Wow, I can actually move this stuff so it won't be twisted and distorted. Any other questions? Okay. Oh, hold on. Yes, there is a... I'll let you do it.
This sound, right?
Yes. Yes. Oh.
Can we maybe dim the light a bit?
Okay, this is a 30-second teaser for the documentary. Thank you, Donkey Well. And you had a question? Right now, I'm sort of in financial limbo. So I'm saving up funds so I can actually sell it either online or direct through various outlets. And the reason why, I have to sell it, a lot of the footage that I was able to find, archival footage, was licensed, and it was very hefty in terms of price. So if this had all been made through Blender, then I certainly would have offered it for free, but I've got to make that money back somehow. Yes?
And you kept saying that technically the aircraft had flew.
Yes.
Is that the only reason that it's because it was so big, so low?
No, there were a number of problems with it. I don't know how much time I have to go into it, but the problem was it was based on very untried technology. I mean, it was something that I don't know how many of you are aviation enthusiasts, but France had come out with a coleopter, as they're called, called the Snecma, and it was a jet-driven type, annular wing type thing. And with a craft like that, the problem you have is that you can't, when you're trying to, it's okay going up, but when you try to come down, how can you see where you're going? Now, Convair, the company that proposed this, had their articulating cockpit, so that the cockpit could actually fold depending on what position the aircraft was in flight. The problem there was that they had an exposed cable at the back of the cockpit, which actually operated the hinge. So, thank you for laughing. So you're not even aircraft designers, and you see how ridiculous that is. So, imagine if you're in flight in a combat situation and cable gets cut somehow. You know, you're in trouble. Another issue was that the pilots had to go up two ladders to get into the cockpit, one on the outside, and then they had to skirt around the rim of the duct to wait for a ladder to drop down from the actual cockpit, and then step onto that, and then go up. So again, imagine you're in a combat situation, and you have to get out very quickly. And I don't think the enemy's going to pause and let you jump down two ladders and say, okay, now you're ready to shoot. It just was a strange but very interesting idea of how to approach the problem of close air support for the U.S. Army. Another notion about this documentary was that when I started this, I only saw one picture, that one picture I showed you guys in the beginning, that still concept photo, and I had no idea if this was real or not, and I actually contacted the San Diego Air and Space Museum, and that day, literally that day, they had just opened up a box that had information on that craft. So this was a series of, making this documentary was a series of happy accidents that just steamrolled, and I thought I was going to make a 5-minute test reel, and it turned out to be a 30-minute documentary. Yes.
Knowing what you know now,
mm-hmm.
if you do had to do again, would you still use Blender?
Of course.
Yeah.
In a heartbeat.
Thanks.
In a heartbeat, yeah. It's fascinating. And now that I've sort of familiarized myself with it, I still call myself a novice. There's so much to learn. And like I said, I wasn't even aware of what the compositor could do, the game engine I'm interested in now, the visual effects, Sebastian Koenig's talk earlier about match tracking. I didn't even know you could do that in that. And then, like I said, I use this as like a sledgehammer to bend it to my will to get a story finished. And that's something I hope that I have inspired in some of you who are sort of fooling around with Blender and haven't really taken the time to create an actual story. Is go for it. You've got nothing to lose. You know, you can. Again, I started this thinking I was going to have 5 minutes, if the most, and I got 5 awards for it. So that's it. Any other questions? That's it. You had enough of me? Okay. Thank you. Now, Max, they don't allow you to pull it out just right. You have to...
I always do it like this. So.
Command E?
No, I don't need to.
Oh, preview. Okay.
I usually just...
Be careful. I can also download them right from the card or find somebody in the middle. If I didn't forget, you can follow me for today.
What? I'm not an amateur.
Okay. So you're not involved in the mafia.
No.
I will email you. I could promise, but I'm not very sure. I still remember after some days. So maybe you should email me.
Okay.
But I didn't have internet. No, I cannot write an email for you. Just for the sake of it. You can find me somewhere.
Well, actually, if you have, I could write it.
Oh, nice.